Okay, so more things left before we can start looking at how scheduling actually happens in a practical operating system. So what I'll do first is the earlier scheduling algorithms that we have looked at, mostly we evaluated them in terms of waiting time. So what other quantities are there that are typically used to measure or evaluate scheduling algorithms that we will quickly look at? Okay, so maybe let us start with that. So what you will usually have is you will have an example scenario like this, where you have a given list of processes, various arrival times, meaning like you start measuring from some t equal to 0, and maybe p1 arrives after 2 milliseconds, p3 arrives after 10 milliseconds, and so forth. So you have an arrival time. That means whatever you are measuring t equal to 0 from, after that much time, pi is created. So basically think of something like a fork over here that results in the creation of pi. So PI becomes ready to run after the fork completes. Usually any process will have, I mean, because any process is created via fork, and really the first thing that it does is the first few instructions in main. So the first thing that it will do is always on the CPU. It will do something on the CPU. Then after it has computed for a while, it will need some input in order to, I mean, say read from disk or read from user or something. So that way it keeps alternating. So some CPU computation, then some input output. In general waiting, but we are assuming that IO is representative of any waiting activity at all. So computation, waiting for something to happen, then more computation and so on, keeps alternating. Last thing again will be the exit system call. So the last burst will have to be a CPU burst. So of course there are other processes also in the system. So this is where PI kind of arrives pod is created, and suppose this is the time where PI finishes, in between there will be some stretches where it does these computations and some stretches where it does the IO. If you have a preemptive scheduling scheme, then it need not do all these CIs in one stretch. It may do a little bit, then it may get preempted, and then some other process runs, and then later on again PI does the rest of whatever work it had to do before it goes for IO and so forth. So given this kind of a general scenario, we already looked at waiting time. So waiting time is, you look at this interval, what durations was PI ready to run but did not get the CPU. So that total is waiting time. So say, assume for simplicity that we have kind of, it runs for CI over here, and then, so say this is CI1 and this is then DI1. So here input output is finished and it is then ready to run. But suppose there is already some other process using the CPU, and maybe PI gets the CPU again over here. So this duration, PI was ready to run but did not get the CPU. So this is part of the waiting time. So you add up all such intervals, you get the waiting time. Turnaround time is basically this entire duration. From the point when PI was created to the point when PI finishes, this total amount of time it took for PI to complete. That includes computation time, IO time, and waiting time when all other processes were running. This total duration is called the turnaround time. Okay, so kind of from a kernel design point of view, what you want to do is, to the extent possible, you want to minimize waiting time. Turnaround time, of course, is not something that is in your hand, because it depends also on what the process itself is doing. So if the process does a lot of computation, then its turnaround time will be more. Before coming to response time, I mean, this is hard to define, but this is really what we will regard as more important when we, or most important when we move to practical scheduling algorithms. Next measure I can talk about is throughput. Throughput is basically number of processes finished per unit time. So maybe say you look at this entire interval, some capital T units of time, and you look at how many processes were finished. So that divided by T is number of processes completed per unit time. That also notice, I mean, okay, you want to increase throughput in general, but throughput will remain, I mean, suppose you have a lot of long running jobs, none of them complete. I mean, you have demand processes, they are all busy, they are all doing some useful work, but they don't ever complete until the system shuts down. So then your throughput is really zero, but that's not a bad thing. So it's useful to know the definition of the quantity, but you don't necessarily want to measure your scheduling algorithms in terms of the throughput. Okay. So what we will really be concerned with are these two, which I have not defined yet. So CPU utilization is easier to define, so let me talk about that first, then I'll talk about response time. So CPU utilization is, again, look at any interval of time and see how much time was spent doing process work. I mean, so basically you look at this duration and add up all these intervals. That is the duration for which CPU was doing actual application work. So that divided by T, the total interval, that is your CPU utilization. Okay. So what things, or when is the CPU not doing application program work? Notice that earlier we said there is really a small interval here which we are kind of assuming is close to zero, where the kernel takes over, does some work, possibly including running the scheduling algorithm, doing the context switch, and then going back to user mode. So for convenience, these kernel mode intervals, they are hopefully small, but we have ignored them altogether. If you really take those details into account, then notice this is not contributing to CPU utilization. It is kind of administrative work. It is not application program running. So these times will kind of not be considered. The other time that will not be considered is if you have a situation where no process is ready to run, then the CPU is idle. So maybe you have some four or five processes. All of them have simultaneously gone to do input-output and they have not finished. So then during that duration, CPU is idle. So that also will not be counted when you are looking at amount of useful work time. Okay, so, yes, question. Sorry. Yeah.
So you said I'll take any particular instance of time, not instance, but interval of time.
Interval.
And then I'll look at these parameters, this particular parameter.
Yeah.
How to decide which interval?
No, I mean you can calculate it for a certain interval of time. So of course it will change from interval to interval.
So
if you look at, think of what you see on your system. If you have a graphic display on the floor, that sometimes spikes, sometimes is kind of, you don't see any activity at all. So that's basically showing you the system load with time. So you see a small interval of time. So maybe say, what it will usually measure it in, say, intervals of, I don't know, maybe 1 second, half a second, or something like that. So every half second, the system measures something like load and shifts your time axis by half second. So for the last, say, depending on how long your x-axis is, for the last n half seconds, your graph is showing you what the load or throughput or utilization or whatever it is. That is what is being displayed.
So, that means if I consider CPU utilization to be a parameter to check any scheduling algorithm, would that be fair? Because it changes with the kind of process that we have.
Right. So, for practical systems, we mostly throw all of this away and start looking at response time. Okay, but so why are we bothering to learn about these things? If you are kind of doing a theoretical analysis of a scheduling algorithm, then you would also have to have something like a load model. So either you run simulations, so you assume that you have some kind of a behavior,
some set of steps.
Right. You have a simulation that will tell you like what processes are created when they do something like a benchmark. So say consisting of 50 processes, you have a table like that. Run your scheduling algorithm on that table and measure it for the total duration of your Gantt chart. That is one possibility. You do it for multiple such benchmark suites and report what you got. So that's a possible scenario that you can use for theoretical analysis. But for practical, I should qualify what I mean by practical. Practical for us means the kind of scheduling algorithm that would be useful in the desktop operating system that we use. Okay, so as I said, certain things are clearly not useful, like turnaround time. If you have a long running process, you expect it to take long. So I'm not necessarily interested in the number of processes being completed for unit time. Likewise for throughput. CPU utilization, of course, I want that to be high. But if you looked at the load display on your laptops or PCs or whatever it is, you will see most of the time they are close to zero. That is actually because most of the time our systems are not loaded. We do heavily input-output bound work. Like say a browser, an editor, a terminal, all of these are heavily input-output bound. They are waiting for you to type something, then it will go off and do something. which usually does not take too much time, and then it will come back and wait for your keystroke or mouse click or something like that again. So because, I mean, even when you have some 4 or 5 or 6 different windows open on your desktop, they are mostly in that waiting state. So which is why, unless there are compute intensive jobs running in the background, your system load line will generally be low. So actually that leads us, so which is kind of one way of saying that CPU utilization will often be low, and that's because of the nature of the load, and it is not necessarily something to be worried about. So then what should we be concerned about? Again, assuming that your scheduling algorithm is targeted for the average desktop user, think of what irritates you. I mean, you type a keystroke or you click a button and the response to that takes a long time. I mean, then you think that the system is slow. So that kind of somewhat hard to concretely define notion is basically what I'm calling response time. So in contrast to, say, turnaround time, is clearly defined when the process, I mean, basically, if you really want to be concrete, then this process, when it is created via fork, at some point of time, the state in the proc structure is changed from being created to ready. That instance, you assume, is the creation time. And the last thing that it does is it calls exit. So when everything else is freed up and just the proc structure remains, somewhere there you say, okay, this is the end time. So that duration is the turnaround time. Okay. Response time is kind of, okay, so let us give one definition of response time, then I'll say how you can define it more generally. So suppose this is where creation time, we know we can define unambiguously. Instead of looking at full completion, we look at the instance when the process gives us some useful output. Okay, now the notion of useful output is vague, which is why I'm saying I'm not giving a concrete definition of response. But it could be something like, say you run a dot out, and a dot out is going to give you some output. So the time that it takes from when you hit enter, loosely speaking, really you should measure it from when the process is created, but when you hit enter and before it gives you the first kind of sum output, that is what I am calling the response time. So what I've just talked about is something like the initial response time. I mean, the process is created and somewhere over here it gives you, say, this is your first, it prints something on the screen. So this is then going to be the response time. The same definition you can generalize to any later point of time. Say it does input output, it actually gets the data, then it becomes ready over here. As I said, over here maybe some other process is running, so it does not get the CPU. So some later point of time it gets the CPU, does some more computation, and then gives you some more output that is useful for you. Then from here, when it got ready, to whatever point over here it is giving you some useful output, that will be the second response time. So for us as ordinary desktop users, response time, even though it's a little hard to concretely define, that is really what is most important and affects our perception of whether the system is kind of working well. Usually the term used is responsive. I mean, if the system is responsive, or whether it's kind of slow and not responsive.
Is it measured in CPU cycles or milliseconds?
Response time. Any unit of time is fine. But the why I'm unable to define it concretely is, what do you regard as useful output? So I say, think of a browser. You click on a link. At the corner it says, looking up such and such host. I mean, do you regard that as useful output? Maybe, maybe not. I mean, maybe you want the first screen to be filled with content before you regard it as useful output. So it's sort of a little subjective. And The reason why that is because you are actually measuring or trying to gauge user satisfaction. So there is an element of subjectivity involved. So we will not try to make it any more concrete than that. But kind of short answer to your question is any unit of time is fine. Milliseconds is fine, CPU cycles is fine, as long as you're using the same unit to compare differentiable algorithms.
So this waiting time and all is all respect to CPU, right? Because if it is waiting for the IO, then we are not counting it in the...
Right. But I agree that is also a useful measure, especially if you have kind of very heavy disk input output, then input output waiting time is also important to know. I mean, especially say when you have a setup like our fourth floor machine, where there is one file server, and all of our, or most of our file IO is happening with respect to that file server, then the IO device or the file server in this case would become an IO bottleneck. So in which case, yes, we would also be concerned about the waiting time on average for IO. So if we have time, then at the very end, we'll have a very superficial look at devices. So at that time, we'll talk about some issues related to disk scheduling or in general IO scheduling. Okay, so the reason why I spent time talking about response time, even though it's hard to define, is as I said, I mean, it's basically what will influence decisions that one takes while designing an scheduling algorithm for a practical operating system. So before starting to look at the scheduling algorithm used in Linux, one of the things that we will see, one of the terms that we will see that is mentioned there is real time. So kind of before jumping into a description of the Linux scheduling scheme, we'll take a quick look at, we'll look at what real time scheduling means in general. So what real-time means is basically, I mean, a real-time system is a system where processes have some requirement to complete some work within a certain duration. Okay, so I guess that's best understood using examples. So consider two programs that you are running. One is some database is being created or being searched, or just think of a browser. These applications, I mean, you want them to be fast naturally, but if they are slow, it is not critical. I mean, you may be irritated, but it is nothing worse than that. So these we are not regarding as real-time processes. Whereas if you have something like, say, a multimedia player that is either playing audio or video, notice that multimedia player, I mean, assume or consider a video player for convenience, notice that it is simultaneously or concurrently operating two devices, the graphic display and your sound card. So there, they are working concurrently, but there is some restriction on the time difference between when a sequence of frames is shown on the display and the corresponding part of the audio track is played on the sound device. Otherwise, I mean the video player does not work as expected in a more precise sense than the browser just being slow. I mean, the browser is expected to show you a page, so maybe it will show it to you in half a second, maybe it will take 5 seconds to show you the page. But the end result is you want to see the page. Whereas for a video, it's actually not working correctly if it's showing you something and playing audio track from somewhere else. So in that sense, a multimedia player is more of a a real-time application than something like an editor or a browser. If we kind of leave aside desktop operating systems and think of special purpose operating systems for special purpose controllers, like say you have in an industry assembly line or some kind of an industrial automation system, there also notice there will be an operating system at work. So you have various sensors and you have various motor parts. So the sensors give some information and the system reacts to that information and produces some response. So to control all of this, there has to be an operating system installed. So especially in a situation like that, I think it's easiest to think of some kind of industry assembly line. See what is happening. Basically, you have some parts on a conveyor belt and maybe some other part, and these parts are being assembled together. So one after the other, two parts are coming, they are being joined together by some kind of a device, and then they are moving on to the next stage in the assembly line. So now notice these two things. It's sort of like the multimedia example, except that here your timing requirements are even more critical. If the two parts don't come together exactly as intended, you're going to get a lot of loose parts on the floor. So, so even among real-time processes, we distinguish between hard real-time and soft real-time. So hard real-time is when okay, it's not really a very concrete black and white distinction, but the more crucial it is for the system to obey timing restrictions, the more hard real time it is. And something like a video player, okay, I mean, it's not going to cause a disaster. I mean, it won't work. So in that sense, it is real time, but it is soft real time in the sense that a failure is not catastrophic. Whereas a failure in an industry assembly line, or say something like you have some kind of a manufacturing process, and say that involves, various chemical inputs and heat and things like that. And whatever that thing is being prepared inside, it has sensors which say, okay, now I already have too much material, so shut off the input. Or the temperature is already high, so don't provide any more heat. So if the response to that, the operating system is busy doing something else and does not respond in a sufficiently short period of time, you're going to get an explosion or something like that. So as I said, I mean, I can't give you a black and white that this is hard, this is soft. But the more crucial it is for the system to fulfill the timing requirements, the harder the real-time requirements are. Otherwise, it's a soft real-time system. So in this context, the next thing to talk about I want to postpone this discussion until after we've had some discussion of process synchronization. Okay, maybe I'll skip this discussion for now. So I hope I remember towards the end of the next chapter, we'll come back and talk about real time again and what it means from a design point of view. So now, for those of you who have not already seen process synchronization, it will not make a whole lot of sense. So I'll skip this one. Okay, so basically I think for now, just I mean what I mentioned, that is adequate. We just need to know that there are processes which have more critical timing requirements than your regular browser editor, etc. So those are the ones that we are calling real-time processes. And right now it's just enough to know only the terminology. Okay, I'm going to look at them in much more detail right now. So then the next thing that we will do is we'll look at how scheduling happens inside a practical operating system. Okay, so the main problem is if you kind of think back to the kind of discussion we had in the previous class, there are very few kind of concrete unqualified answers. I mean, everything pretty much seemed to have some advantage, some disadvantage. Something like round robin is, okay, it's a good idea, but there again, you have this undecided question of what should I choose the time quantum to be? If it's too short, then my utilization is going to be bad. If it's too long, then it's going to be like FCFS. So, I mean, as you might imagine, it's a hard problem. And there are no kind of well-defined optimal answers. So these are some of the requirements for that we have to keep in mind when designing a practical scheduler. As opposed to discussing theoretical scheduling algorithms. As I said, most important thing is going to be, for a desktop operating system. So basically right now we are confining our attention to a desktop operating system. Most important criterion is going to be fast process response time. So because that is what is going to govern the user's perception of whether the system is working well or not, that is what we want to optimize. But at the same time, you don't want the other processes to be much slower than required. And certainly you want, in a practical system, you cannot have starvation. So basically, it's a fairly hard problem. So we'll see how it has been solved in two versions. So an older version, substantially old version of the Linux kernel, the 2.4 version. Why we will talk about it is because the algorithm is relatively straightforward. It's fairly simple. You can actually look at kernel code, and it's written in C, and it's reasonably understandable. So that shows you that a practical scheduling algorithm does not have to be frightfully complicated. I mean, it has ingredients from various theoretical scheduling algorithms that we've looked at. But the code, more or less, you can make out what is happening. Then we'll discuss what problems it had and why people were not happy with it, so that in a later version, people drop that algorithm and redesign the scheduling algorithm in 2.6 onwards to get rid of the disadvantages of the 2.4 scheduler. So the 2.6 scheduler, unfortunately, especially compared to the 2.4 scheduler, is frightfully complicated. So I don't think we will be able to do a step 1, step 2, step 3 kind of discussion the way we will look at the 2.4. But at least we'll look at some of the major design decisions that went into the 2.6 schedule. So supposing we start by making a list of the theoretical scheduling algorithms that we looked at. So we started with FCFS. I'm not separately writing shortest job first because it's a special case of priority-based scheduling algorithms. Multi-level queue, and the general version of this is multi-level queue with feedback. Plain multi-level queues are a restricted version of this. So I think these are the four major kinds of scheduling algorithm that we looked at from a theoretical point of view. So what we will see is the both the 2.4 and the 2.6 scheduler use ideas from all four of these. So okay, so as I said, I mean maybe we can start with the 2.4 scheduler because that's much simpler. Start with 2.4, then I'll show you where these theoretical scheduling algorithms have come into the picture. Okay, so maybe it's best to start with, if you recall, I mean out of these, this was the one, I mean other than the question of deciding what the quantum is, this is really the one that seemed to be most practical. So we will use this as a starting point of, for the 2.4 scheduler, and then add ingredients from the others. Okay, correction. I'll start with this. I'll explain why. Most of the time we'll spend talking about round robin. So multi-level queue . So this is in the context of the 2.4 scheduler. So there are actually two queues. One is for we have two separate queues, one for real-time processes and one for non-real-time, otherwise called conventional processes. So this is basically the kind of the top-level nature of the 2.4 scheduler is a multi-level queue. Okay, one small digression, real-time, are we talking here about hard real-time or soft real-time? We are talking about soft real-time, Linux does not support hard real-time. Okay, so we will spend all our time talking about, I mean, the usual editor, browser, terminal kind of process. So we will confine our attention to this queue of the multi-level queue. Okay, so inside conventional process, it's really a mixture of okay, FCFS, I'll get it out of the way by saying that first come first serve is used for breaking ties. Other than that, first come first serve does not play too much of a role. So how does round robin and priority play a role in scheduling conventional processes? Basically, the algorithm is a round robin scheduling algorithm, which means, remember, that every process is given some amount of computing time and it will run for that amount of time, after which it will be preempted. So then the question that we considered in the previous class and that I raised today also is what do you decide the quantum to be? So in the 2.4 scheduler, that is sort of where the priority comes into the picture. So the way it works is roughly a high priority process is given more time, a low priority process is given less time. Okay, we'll actually see that the implication is really the other way around. Let me step back and talk about why that makes sense. So think about what we are trying to do. We are trying to create a responsive desktop operating system. So as I said, the things that matter most to the user are the interactive processes. Interactive processes, if you look at their nature, they spend less time doing computing and much more time doing I/O. Waiting for I/O mainly. I mean, you do, it's waiting for your keystrokes or your mouse button. You hit one key or you type or you click a mouse button, it does something and then quickly goes back again to waiting for your next input. So the processes that we want to favor, they are heavily input-output bound. Whereas something like a huge matrix factorization program or something that is very compute intensive, I mean, in any case, it's going to take time. So maybe it's a difference between, say, 5 minutes and 10 minutes. If it's that kind of a program, I'm sure you want it to finish in 5 minutes rather than 10. But it's not the kind of program where you're waiting for it to respond all the time. If you're waiting for it anyway, you might as well wait for 10 rather than 5. So that is the kind of rationale behind why the kernel is designed, or the scheduler is designed to favor, or we want it to favor interactive processes rather than compute intensive processes. So now, how are we going to achieve that? Suppose that initially, what the question that you should really be asking is, how do I know? I mean, how does the kernel know what is a compute intensive process and what is a interactive process? I mean, the processes aren't labeled like that, right? And indeed, processes' nature can change over time. If you have, say something like, if you have a video editor, then when you are putting different pieces of your video together, it is an interactive program. When you have put everything together and you give it to render one continuous video file, then that becomes compute intensive. So it's not practical to say, or even a browser. I mean, when you are playing some flash video, you will notice that the load line spikes. So that is when it is relatively compute intensive. One or two clicks here and there and three or four pages loading simultaneously, I mean, notice that it's depending mostly for network traffic. So it's not compute intensive at all. So which means that it's not practical to label applications with fixed labels like compute intensive, non-compute intensive. In any case, I mean, if I run a dot out, I mean, what is the system going to regard it as? So, assume initially the kernel gives the same amount of computing time to all processes. So, after a while, what is going to happen? If it is a compute intensive process, then it will get the CPU frequently and it will use up its time quantum. Whereas an input-output bound process, in the same duration, it has spent a lot of its time waiting for I/O. So at the end of that interval, it probably still has a lot of, I mean, given the same starting duration, it has more left over. So what I really meant to say, instead of saying that high priority processes are given more time and low priority processes are given less time, what I really want to say is, anything that has a lot of allocated computation time left over, the kernel assumes that that is an interactive process and accords it high priority. Anything, you give it a ration and it quickly exhausts its ration, kernel concludes that that is a compute intensive process and gives it lower priority. So based on what we have discussed so far, kind of a skeleton of the scheduling algorithm will look like. Okay, so initial means initial for a process. So when a process is created, it's going to be created by a fork. If it's created by a fork, the parent process already has some quantum. So whatever quantum it has is going to be divided into two parts. Half remains with the parent and remaining half is going to be given to the child. So initial quantum assignment to a process is kind of, so that question we have addressed. When this is created via fork, split the parent's value of the quantum, give half to the child, give half to the parent. Fine. So now at any given point of time when I run the scheduler, each ready to run process has some quantum assigned to it. Okay. So naturally it makes sense only to consider processes which have a non-zero quantum remaining. So out of all the processes that have a non-zero quantum remaining, remember the rationale was whoever has more left is sort of more IO bound. So I kind of look at which process has the maximum quantum left and I give the CPU to that process. So yes, question.
Quantum should be allocated to that so that it can give half to each process.
What I have kind of implied now is that you start out with a certain amount and you keep creating processes, it keeps going down. So I'll come to that question. Remember I said when you have, when you're running the scheduling algorithm, first thing is you're considering only ready to run processes. The second thing I said is that it only makes sense to run ready-to-run processes if they have a leftover quantum. So then the question that you should be worried about is, what if I have run out of my quantum but I still have work to do? So that is essentially your question. Your desktop manager starts giving out half its quota. What is it going to do eventually? So we'll come to that question. Assume for now that there are some ready to run processes which have non-zero quota left with them. So the kernel simply chooses whichever process has the maximum. It assumes that that is the most interactive process and gives it the highest priority. So basically, now you see that it's both round robin and priority rolled into one. The round robin comes over here and the priority is depending on how much leftover quantum a process has, you are going to give it some priority. Fine. So say you select some process, it spends some computing time. Now, as you pointed out, sooner or later it is going to run out of its quantum. What do we do then? So the kernel, this the period when all ready-to-run processes have exhausted their time quantum, the kernel calls that the end of an epoch. So when all ready to run processes have have exhausted their time quantum, what are we going to do? So at this point, the kernel refills the quantum for all processes. So what is the kind of, and that marks the beginning of what's called a new epoch. So basically at this stage, when this occurs, that the kernel scans through the list of ready to run processes and finds that everybody has exhausted their allocated quantum, then it will go back and allocate time quantum to all processes. I'll make that distinction again because it is important. not only ready to run processes, but waiting process also, they will get a fresh ration. So that marks the beginning of a new epoch. Now again, you have ready to run processes with non-zero quantum allocated. So again, the priority-based scheduling starts. So kind of specific answer to your question is, say your desktop manager, that gets an initial time quantum. Then as you create terminal window, browser, or editor, this, that, and the other, it is sharing its quantum. So what will happen is, after a point, desktop manager will run out. Okay. If at that point there are ready to run processes, then that ready to run process will have to exhaust its quantum before the desktop manager is going to be refilled. So think of the following scenario. You have the desktop manager, it was given some say Q1 amount of time or delta 1 amount of time. You now say click a terminal, open a terminal. So now the desktop manager has delta 1, your terminal has, delta 1 by 2, your terminal has delta 1 by 2. Inside your terminal, you run some huge compute intensive task. So what is going to happen is, this is again going to get split, delta 1 by 4 with the terminal and delta 1 by 4 with your edit out. So now this still has some ration left. So if you click on other things, this will still be able to work for some time. But if you create more processes using your desktop manager, this ration will also keep dropping. At some point, maybe what will happen is, your terminal has exhausted its quantum, desktop has exhausted its quantum. So the only thing that is left is your A dot out. So then what will happen is, everything else will stop responding. So you move your mouse, I think the mouse will move because that's a kind of device handling arrangement. But until your compute intensive process exhausts its time quantum, nothing else is going to respond. But if it is compute intensive, it will sooner or later exhaust its quantum. So we are never going to get into a kind of problematic situation where there is nothing that can be done. As long as there are ready to run processes, they will be getting the CPU, they will be using their quantum. Sooner or later, they'll finish their allocated ration. When every ready to run process has exhausted its allocated ration, we'll go back and refill everybody. Okay, so in fact, that is one disadvantage of the 2.4 scheduler that we will talk about later, and we'll look at how it was addressed in the 2.6 scheduler.
Sir, yes. This means that within an epoch, so we have 5 processes, one of them very quickly exhausts its time quantum. So he has to wait for all the other ones to finish.
Absolutely, yes.
So the waiting time, if waiting time is not a good thing to measure here, I guess, but waiting time will increase for
him. Absolutely, absolutely. So the intended effect was that, say this is a very compute intensive job, so you give it a quantum, it quickly exhausts it. So now what is that process waiting for? It's really waiting for your browser, your editor, the other more interactive processes. It is waiting until they finish all theirs, then it will get a new quantum. Okay, so that's kind of the overall picture of what happens in the 2.4 kernel. So now I think we are ready to look at the specific details. Erase that part. Remember that we start with, at the high level view, is this. At the highest level, the 2.4 scheduler looks like a multi-level queue. What are the two queues? One queue corresponds to real-time processes and the other corresponds to non-real-time or conventional processes.
Sir?
Yes.
A process is a conventional process or real-time process? How you know this?
Okay, so there are if you want a process to be a real-time process, you have system calls which say that, okay, make me a real-time process. For that, naturally, certain privileges are required. So otherwise, I mean, you would want to run your VI as a real-time process, right? So unless, I mean, the usual protections are ordinary users will not be able to make their processes real-time. Okay, so the I'll step back a bit and make a general remark here. So notice that, I mean, what did we say the kernel is? The kernel is a set of library functions essentially, which take care of complicated low-level interactions with the hardware. Okay, so then if it is a set of library functions, then it's a lot of code like any other library. Okay, so what is that code written in? I mean, in order for it to execute, it must consist of a series of machine instructions. Do we necessarily want to write the kernel straight away in assembly? Probably not. Parts of it will have to be written in assembly. But as long as you have a compiler available to you, there is no reason why we should not write the compiler, the kernel itself in C. So the code that we will look at here, it's written in C and compiled. So once it is compiled, you get executable in machine level instructions. So there is no problem. So things that I talk about here, I mean, we are looking at the high level kernel code that is written in C. So remember that all of this notation corresponds to the parts of the kernel written in C, and they are compiled eventually to generate the actual kernel. Okay, so how do we distinguish between these two queues? Remember, there is a real-time queue and a non-real-time or conventional process queue. The way this is distinguished is via inside the proc structure. As I mentioned, I mean, remember the proc structure has lots of fields. So in a C program, what would you use in order to write the proc structure? A struct type. So the, not surprisingly, in the kernel, the proc structure is a struct type. One of its fields is this RT underscore priority for real-time priority. So basically, the distinction that is made is if RT priority is 0, then it is a conventional process. And actual real-time processes get an RT priority from 1 to 99. So that kind of division into two queues is made on the basis of the value of RT priority. Non-zero means real-time, zero means conventional. So this RT priority is actually called static because it is kind of assigned early on in the life of a process and does not kind of keep changing over time. Dynamic priority is basically something like when the scheduler actually runs, in order to choose between multiple conventional processes, all of which have zero static priority, that is when this dynamic priority is going to be used. And as the name suggests, dynamic priority will keep changing over time. And based on what we have discussed so far, this dynamic priority is really what is kind of tied to how much time quantum each process has. Okay, so the next thing that we will look at is, say if T is a pointer to proc structure, then the proc structure has a field called counter. So this field keeps track of So if you want to run a real-time application, you have to, inside that process, you have to make a system call to request that my status be changed to real time.
Yes.
And the kernel will check whether you have the appropriate privileges. And if you do, then it will change your scheduling class from regular conventional to real time.
No, I meant that within those also you will assign priority, like some
right.
will be higher.
Right,
than
sure. Level. So basically the process requests it. I mean, like you make a system call saying I want to be a real time process with say priority 99
okay.
or I want to be a real time process with priority 1. By default it will remain a conventional process. So what real time process you want a particular process to be, that happens via system call. Usual request to the kernel will check whether you are permitted to get that real time priority and either grant or deny that request. So so this particular system call, I can't tell you offhand what system call it is, but we will see a related idea that kind of we can use in our regular programs as ordinary users, which allow us to change the priority of our processes to an extent. So all of this happens via system calls. One kind of system call of limited utility we will look at more carefully later on. But the same idea applies to your question also.
Sir, can this happen that two real-time processes ask the kernel to give them the same priority?
Yes, yes, yes. And my recollection is that when that happens, I mean, you have to be very careful because the kernel does absolutely first-come, first-serve scheduling and kind of priority across the real-time queues. So if you end up creating buggy real-time processes, your system will hang. I mean, it will start with the highest priority real-time, finish it before it does anything else. That's part of the requirement of being real time.
Finish it, it will complete totally, then
add another
one?
No, it has to be, I mean, for as long as it's ready to run, I mean, whichever is the highest priority real time ready to run process, for as long as it remains ready to run, it will get the CPU. If it goes away, then it will look at, so basically over here, highest priority is priority 1. 99 is lowest priority and the conventional are even, no, is that right? No, must be other way around because 0 is conventional processes, so then right, it must be the other way around. 99 must be the highest priority. I think the two are handled differently. But anyway, I mean, the answer to your question is that you start looking at the highest priority real-time queue, service it in first come first served order. Each process, when it finishes its time quantum, then the process will, the kernel will schedule the next process. And it will go through the all the real-time queues before considering the conventional processes. So, and that is kind of totally preemptive. So suppose you are doing some middle-level real-time, and then something happens and makes a higher priority real-time ready, this will get preempted and that one will run. So which is why you need to be careful with real-time processes. Right, so this counter field inside the proc structure is the field where you store the allocated quantum to this So this is just an integer and its unit is basically what's kind of defined as a clock tick. So that again that is a parameter, you decide whether what is the duration of a clock tick. So every time, I mean okay, so the clock is a very high frequency device, but maybe you use those that kind of that frequency to define a time interval. And you decide what the duration of that interval is going to be, and that is basically what is defined as a clock tick. So whichever is the currently run process, when it gets the timer interrupt after one clock tick, it will basically do P counter minus minus. Means the currently running, for the currently running process, one unit or one clock tick time has been used up. So this counter is then decremented. Okay, so then once we have this, the essence of the scheduling algorithm is it will look at the list of, I remember at the very beginning we said that your proc structures are, apart from a tree-like hierarchy, it is also on several hash queues and it is on several scheduling queues. So the kernel will look at the ready queue, it will do a linear scan, find which process has the maximum counter. We said our policy was choose the value or choose the process which has the highest counter and select that for giving the CPU. So basically the scheduling algorithm looks like a simple a linear scan of a linked list. So it will be a for loop, look at each, keep track of the maximum value and which process had that maximum, select that process. If in this pass you find that the maximum value was 0, what does that mean? That means that all the ready to run processes have exhausted their time quantum. So then the kernel realizes that, okay, this is the end of an epoch. So then it goes back to reallocation of all processes. So it will recompute quantum and assign a fresh quantum to every process. Okay, so now I think we are ready to look at the actual code. Okay, so counter I have already talked about. Apart from counter, there is also another field called nice. This is probably there for historical reasons. So what nice is, I mean, think of what I said about real-time processes. Real-time processes, I said you have non-zero RT priority, and that RT priority can have a value from 1 to 99. All conventional processes have zero RT priority. So far, I mean, the suggestion or what I've been talking about is everything gets decided based on counter. That is actually not correct. What happens is the system looks at a combination of this and this, which is something like static priority for conventional processes. So each conventional process gets a nice value. Nice values go from minus 19 to plus 20. Minus 20 to plus 90. And there again, I mean, the lower the value, the higher the priority. A high value means low priority. So, kind of the picture that I have been suggesting so far is that you have kind of confusing, no? I mean, here, so what I'm saying is 1 to 99, this is real time. General thing seems to be, and this is kind of all zero. So these are so the picture I have been suggesting is that there are 99 queues here and one queue for conventional. And this we are basically not looking at. Over here we will choose everything based on quantum. So that is kind of not really correct. Over here, apart from key P counter, you also have a second scheduling parameter called P nice. And while trying to find the best process to select, instead of just looking at the maximum value of counter, which is what I suggested earlier, it looks at some combination of counter, nice, and certain other factors. So it really computes using these things and some other factors, it computes what is called a goodness. So there is a goodness function. What does the goodness function take? It basically, you give it a proc structure. It will look at the current P counter value. It will look at the P nice value. It will look at certain other parameters and compute a number. That number is basically, I mean, when I said there is a maximum finding loop, what you really find is the maximum of that number rather than simply the maximum of the counter. So now let us look at the code.
Sir, isn't P nice also a part of real-time processes?
No, I think P nice would only make sense for conventional. Because over here, if I am remembering things correctly, over here the scheduling is kind of highest priority first, and nothing is kind of rather preemptive highest priority first. So only when everything is empty here, you are going to consider here, and here you have 99 levels anyway, so it's probably not required to have nice things over here also. So the nice value will be used, I mean, I'm guessing, but it's likely that because all of these have zero real-time priority, the nice only makes sense over here.
Sir, there was a Unix command nice,
which has to do with this, absolutely. So you have both a system call and a command line command, both of which end up calling the same system call, and that basically changes this nice value. Why it's called nice is, if you increase the nice value, then your process is nice to other processes, which means that it lowers its priority and gives other processes a chance to run. In fact, I mean, in connection with your question, when you said I have to request or make a system call in order to make a particular process a real-time process. So likewise, from within any program, I can call the nice function to change my priority. But ordinary user processes can only increase their niceness, which means decrease their priority. Whereas if you want to increase your priority and decrease your niceness, you have to have super user privileges by default. I mean, that is how it works.
Sir, can the real-time processes manipulate their priority once already being assigned? Like, say, can they increase or decrease their priority?
I should think so. So, I mean, you're concerned about why it's called static priority then?
Yes, sir.
I mean, because it happens via a system call. Again, I mean, this is just a guess. I haven't looked at the code, I haven't looked at the related system calls, but I'm guessing it does. I mean, it's not like if you've called that system call once, you're forbidden from trying to call it again. I should think you can, I mean, you decide that you want real-time priority some 50. You later you want to change that. I should think there are system calls which permit you to do that.
And sir, in case I am running, say all my real-time processes have been executed, and now I am running a conventional process, and in the meantime a real-time process again comes to me, so will I preempt it?
Absolutely. So that happens across all levels. I mean, any time a higher priority real-time process comes, it preempts everything that is lower priority. Right, okay, so counter we have already looked at, nice. Right, I don't know which one I finally said. It goes from minus 20 to plus 19. Zero is the default value. Positive means you are nice to others, as I said, that means lower priority. Negative means not nice, higher priority. And as I said, I mean, you can only decrease your nice value only if you are a super user, if you have super user privileges. Okay, so what sense does this function call make? Well, I mean, as an ordinary user, why would you seek to reduce the priority of your process? So that it's typically used by long-running processes which run in the background, which you use occasionally, but which should not interfere with, say, your regular browser editor terminal, that kind of thing. So one specific example that I know of is something like a, say, desktop search engine. Have any of you used a desktop search engine?
Google Desktop.
Right, that has become defunct now, but once upon a time you used to have Google Desktop. You have other things like, I think one is called Beagle. There's something called Recall, R-E-C-O-L-L. So they basically, you say that my important files reside in XYZ directories. It goes and indexes them, and then it will give you a search bar where you can say, I want to find a file containing some keywords. So that kind of taking, depending on how many files you have, your desktop search engine will take some time to index all your files. Especially say you have a collection of some several hundred PDF files and you want to index them, that will take time. So usually what happens is these desktop search engines, at the very beginning, they will increase their nice value. It's your process, you are running it, but you don't want it to interfere with the things that you are using all the time. So at system startup, it will start up and start indexing the files, but with low priority. When you're not doing anything else, it will index some more files. So that's one practical example I know of where a positive nice value is actually used in order to consciously decrease priority. Okay, so now, as I said, I mean, we want to look at two things. One is the nature of the maximum finding loop, which is fairly straightforward. That maximum finding loop deals with what is basically deals with the goodness function. The goodness function looks at p counter, p nice, and some other parameters which I have not mentioned yet to compute the actual kind of score for a process. And that's basically used in the maximum finding loop. So now if you look at the code, that should be next. Oh, you can't see. But anyway, I mean, look at the reference and you look at the slides offline. Basically what you have here is the maximum finding loop. So it's absolutely not different from what you've written in your programming or data structures classes. You said something like your maximum to minus infinity. Consider each, this run queue head is basically a pointer to the WDK list containing ready to run processes. So you consider each of these. You set P to be like for E, like basically something like for P equal to head of run queue, P not null, and P goes to P next. This is basically a macro for that. P is the proc structure. If you skip this condition, essentially what you're doing is calling the goodness function and giving it a pointer to the proc structure. And the goodness function is returning some kind of a weight. If this weight is bigger than C, then you update the maximum and you update which process gave you the maximum. So at the end of this maximum finding loop, this next is basically pointing to the proc structure of the process that you have selected or that your scheduling algorithm has selected. If after this loop, you find that your maximum weight is zero, that means all ready-to-run processes have exhausted their time quota. So that means the current epoch has ended and a new epoch has to begin. What is the main thing we do in a new epoch? Allocate all processes a fresh quantum. All processes, that's an important thing to keep in mind, not only the ready-to-run processes. So notice the difference. This is basically running across the run queue list. This is doing for each task E, meaning for all processes. You take the proc structure P and its counter value is this formula. So what is it? You get 1 by default. You get something that depends on nice. So if you have the default value, this is 20 minus P nice, integer division with 4. So that means if you have default P nice value of 0, you'll get 20 by 4, which is 5 plus 1. 6, your minimum is what you're getting. If you have maximum priority, that means P nice is what it is, say minus 9 P 19. So then this will become 39 by 4. So you get 9 over here plus 1, 10. On the other hand, if you have a nice value of 20, then you don't get anything over here at all, you just get this 1. So this part is added together with what is the first expression? First expression is half of your leftover counter. So if you have exhausted your time quantum in the previous epoch, then you are compute bound. You don't get any benefit. But you get only the default part determined by your nice value and this one. If you are an interactive process and you have substantial, you're not ready to run, but you have substantial counter left over, you get to carry forward half of that. This right shift by 1, notice, is essentially division by 2. So you get half of your leftover quantum from the previous epoch plus whatever everybody is getting. So which means that interactive processes, kind of every time an epoch ends, depending on how much quantum they have left over, they get to carry forward half of that into the next epoch. And remember, our goodness works on how much counter you have left. So their interactive nature, they carry forward from the previous epoch to the next epoch.
Is there any particular reason for dividing by 4?
No, these are absolutely arbitrary. I mean, over here at least you're doing division by 2, division by 4. In the 2.6 scheduler, we'll see even more strange numbers. And I have no idea why they are there. I suppose people tried this and that and found it worked well, so they've kept it there. So then the only missing detail here is the goodness part. So how much time do we have left?
11:15.
I think it's going to take a while to... I mean, basic idea is simple enough that you combine counter and nice and give a goodness value, but... there are some details that are going to take time to explain. So that we will do the next class. So next class is on Tuesday. Okay, fine. So we will complete this on Tuesday and then move on to 2.6.
What are the practical?
Sorry, yes?
Practical.
Practical, yes. For what I'll do first is I'll mail you the problems. You do the